So just to fix again the notation, I will start with recalling the background we had on multidimensional continuous fractions. Then, I will discuss the two topics I will discuss mainly here will have to do with convergence issues and existence of invariant measure and invariant measure absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure. So that will be the two main questions I will handle here, and I will spend some time on fully subtractive algorithm. This is the example I gave at the end of my first lecture when I shown you that there might be troubles with convergence, so I will spend some time on this. And at the end, I will discuss various issues and making connections with Perron-Frobenius theory and products of non-negative matrices. So just to be clear with the notation, we have seen already this definition. We will work with a multidimensional continuous fraction expressed as a piecewise fractional linear maps. That is to say, we work on a subset x of 0, 1 to the d. So x will be a polygon, a half of the cube. But we can assume that mu is as positive a measure, compact, convex. So in fact, concretely, it will be either hold the cube or half of it or something like that. And then we will divide x as a countable union of cylinders. The cylinders will be mostly polygons, but we can at least say that the boundary is zero, but there will be usually polygons. On each cylinder, we are given a matrix AK, which is invertible, which has integer coefficients. And we will assume that it inverse, that we will call BK, as non-negative entries. And then the map we will consider works like that on each cylinder. It maps a d-upple to another d-upple according to the following rule. The new entry is equal to ak, a of k, the old entry. And if we want to write things in a convenient way, the entry you had is already expanding with expanded with respect to t. T restricted to ck with respect to the matrix bk, which I call now ak minus 1, which I'll call bk. And for notation, I will call Mn the product of my matrices B1, Ba, which are non-negative. OK, so that's the framework where we were. And the question now is the question of convergence. So I will give several definitions concerning convergence. So what kind of convergence can we have? Well, I will also introduce more notations. My matrix Mn will have entries labeled like that. And the denominators of my convergence that I am producing are on the first line, which is the largest line. So here are my denominators. The Qn I'm looking for when I make continuous fractions. So the convergence, the properties we can have could be that we have a limit given by the first column of the matrix, for instance, which gives you that that we want to have a convergence of B I 0 n divided by the denominator. We want this to converge toward our quantity xi if x has entries x1, xd. So we might want this limit to exist. So the limit first exists. We might want this limit to be equal to the number that we are expanding. We might want also consider a better quality of approximation. We might want to renormalize things. We might want this quantity to tend to zero. So these are convergent types of arithmetic nature.
What is B and what is M?
It's M, thank you very much. So these are the entries I've produced with my matrix, my products of matrices. So here I have non-negative matrices. I produce a larger matrix, and then I am trying to approximate my entries with respect to the data given by this matrix. So that's convergence of arithmetic type, but we also have seen the notion of topological convergence, which is the following. To a point X, associate the sequence, the coding of its orbit under the action of X. Under the map T, with respect to the cylinders C of K. So that is to say, T n minus 1 of X belong to the cylinder CKn. So once we have this notation, the topological convergence means that we would like that the cylinder of order n associated to X shrinks to X. That is to say, the intersection of the cylinders when n tends to infinity, that the data produced by the algorithm, the coding of the algorithm, gives you everything about X. That is to say that this intersection reduces to X. So we have several notions. And then when I say that, it's reasonable to ask for something which holds almost everywhere and not for every X, because of the fact that the orbits can be finite. So we won't, once again, spend much time on points which fall onto the boundaries of the intervals. So these properties are expected to hold almost everywhere with respect to X and with respect to the Lebesgue measure, mu, on 0, 1 to the d. So for all these properties, I expect them to hold almost everywhere. So now the question is what the connections between these properties. So here I recommend a nice paper by Kreikamp and Mester on the convergence and the discussion on the various types of convergence of these algorithms. I think it's a 98, something like that. And then what happens is that, which is quite natural, we have equivalence between this property and this property. So I will call this 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's not difficult to see that, 2 is equivalent to 4. That is to say, if the what you produce converges to the right, to the expected value, the data you had at the beginning, then it's the same thing that saying you have this property on the cylinders. So this holds true under the assumptions that the cylinders are, the fundamental domains are polygons. Okay, so we have this equivalence. So just to have an idea of what happens, if this failed, that means that would mean that we would have to produce two sequences with the same data intervals. Cylinders, you would produce two numbers, but then they determine completely these values, but these values determine the parameter x. But what is interesting is that they produce an example where so there exists an example of map T for which one holds. But 4 fails. That is to say, the limits might exist. They are not equal to the initial data, and we don't have topological convergence. So we have to be careful when we look at such limits. You might also think that focusing on the first column is unfair, and in fact, it's completely true. There is no reason to focus on the first column. So we can also ask here to have such a condition for every column. So when you have something which depends on every column, we call this type of convergence uniform. So now what they prove in this nice paper is that if the map T is expanding, that is to say, its Jacobian is larger than 1 in a modulus, its value in absolute value. If T is expanding, then if 1 holds uniformly, I mean by that. So what we have just said here for every column, then we have topological convergence. So the situation is not that bad. If you are able to have a limit for every column, if you have once again reasonable cylinders, which are polygons, then you have a convergence, topological convergence. We are still mentioning vocabulary. So this limit is called weak convergence. And this type of limit is called strong convergence. What does it mean in more geometrical terms? Mn is a matrix, so I have said, with non-negative entries. So Mn applied to the positive cone is a cone. So you have the question is whether you are contracting the cones, and it's a cone generated by the column of these matrices of this matrix. It's okay. So suppose you have one dimension 3. You have something like that, and the question of weak convergence has to do with the fact that the columns have an angle which tends to zero. So whether the colons converge to a direction in angle, we don't care about the length of things. So that's the weak convergence. But for the strong convergence, we want more. We want to have something on the distance between the colons. So suppose my matrix is written like that, to have more natural notations. So here I'm putting the vector p, n, rn, qn, same thing with dash and double dash. So here, for the weak, the strong convergence, I want this distance, the distance to tend to zero. So when I say write theta n, I mean if I am in uniform mode, I take the three possible angles, the three possible distances. And so weak convergence has to do with contraction just without taking care of the stretching factor, convergence towards something. And strong convergence means that we take care of the distances. And so the convergence is toward the initial vector we had, x. And so we have added a dimension, so the vector 1x, which is supposed to be in this cone. And 1x belongs to this cone by definition. So in particular, this vector belongs to the intersection of all these cones. And the question of topological convergence or the question of weak convergence is whether these nested cones are reduced to a line. So we are really very close to what Mike has discussed within the framework of Perron-Frobenius theory. So we have two issues. Do these cones converge to a single direction, and do we have even some information concerning the distances? So now that we have some vocabulary concerning convergence, I will introduce something which will prove to be very useful in terms of invariant measure and ergodic theory of these systems, is the notion of Jacobian, which is completely natural in this framework. So first I will consider the inverse branches. I will take the following notation. V is the inverse of T . So T is not invertible. So what do I mean by this? Well, on each cylinder, we will have a map VK, which is the inverse of the restriction of T over CK. Then we have a map which goes from the image of each cylinder to the cylinder, and which is the inverse branch of T over CK. For instance, in the continuous fraction case, V of the partial quotient K is 1 over K plus X. It has very simple formulation. And VK is given by the inverse of the matrix AK, that is to say by our non-negative matrix BK. And it works as we have seen before. The image of X by VK is given by the action of the matrix BK on 1X. So now we can define the Jacobian of our continued fraction. It's just the Jacobian of the map VK applied to X. Uh, So if we have several, see if we have not only the starting fundamentals, but more complicated cylinders, then just a remark, the action of Vk1 Kn on x, it maps x to the cylinder Ck1 Kn. So here I just have some small detail. Here I don't work with full cylinders, full fundamental intervals. That is to say, the image of this interval, this I call them intervals, but we are in the dimensional space. These domains are not necessarily full. The images are not necessarily equal to the full space. Well, so that's a detail. Okay, so we have this Jacobian, and so what is it for? What does it give us as information? Well, it's connected to what Pierre said yesterday concerning the density of our transformation. So remember, yesterday I introduced a density operator, which is also called Perron-Frobenius operator, or Kuzmin operator, or or whatever, there are several names. So it's really connected to, if I'm not mistaken, to the words of introduction. You said there's a Perron-Frobenius theory on this framework, which is similar to what you've seen in matricial terms. And even Ruel, I shouldn't forget. But well, so the way, so it's an operator P, which acts on L1 of space. So P of F is, so F is a density, and we would like to know how the density is transformed under the action of our algorithm. So suppose to fix the idea is that you, instead of starting with the Lebesgue measure on the interval 0, 1, you start with another density. And then you apply one of the maps of the intervals you've seen, like of the many maps Karma has described, beta transformation, any kind of expansion. You would like to know how the points after that are spread on the unit interval, knowing that from scratch you didn't start with Lebesgue measure but with another repartition. Well, the way that this repartition will be modified, so start the repartition is given by F, will be given by PF, it's a new density, which works as follows. Take all the pre-images of some X, so it's a density that acts on a starting space, and then what the result will be. So here I just write this in the one-dimensional setup just to fix the ideas. The way you will create a new density depends on what you had in the pre-images. The pre-images bring you some density that's just a slope corresponding to the density. So we want to know where the points come from, and it gives you density. So another way to write this is a sum over the inverse branch. Our map is highly non-injective, so you take the inverse branches. So it's the sum of the over the inverse branches of f of h of x, h prime of x. This may be the best way to feel how the density has been perturbed by the inverse branch. So we want, so that's exactly the equation Pierre wrote yesterday and said the Gauss measure is, the density of the Gauss measure is a fixed point under this operator. Well, we have exactly the same setting here. We have an operator also, which is, which works on X, the or subspace, subset of the d-dimensional unit cube, which gives you that it's the sum over the branches, the inverse branches labeled by K, of the action of F of the inverse branch times, well, we have prepared all the notation, the Jacobian at x. So there are many commas. So it depends on x. So you take the Jacobian at x, and you run over the inverse branches. If we still look at continued fractions, so we have seen that the inverse branches are 1 over k plus x. So v of k1, kn corresponds to the action of the continued fraction. We just write the Jacobian directly. So I will take a y here, we'll feel more comfortable. It's just this nice expression. So that's for continued fraction. But here in our general setting, it's not difficult to see that the Jacobian is given by, so if I work in absolute value, it's given by the determinant of our matrix B. That's matrix B, which gives you the inverse branches. So it's equal to the absolute value of the determinant divided by the action of the matrix M. So we have M0, 0, 0, N plus M0, 1, N, Y1 plus M0, D, N, YD. That is to say, it's just what corresponds to the denominator via something which depends on the other columns on the top line, which corresponds to all the denominators. So that's such a condition, modulo some power, which depends on the dimension. And by the way, I forgot a square. So the expression here of my operator will be very simple, my density operator. It's something which depends on inverse branches, which are just fractional linear maps as we had, times something which depends on the numerator. So we have the same kind of relations as we had with usual continued fractions. But as you've seen with Pierre's lecture, it's not that obvious to find the fixed point via this equation. So our aim will not be to find, for the moment, explicit fixed points, just to know whether we have an invariant measure and how it behaves with respect to Lebesgue measure. So I will introduce for this condition, sufficient condition of existence and ergodicity of invariant measure, which will use ideas you've seen with the proof, the sketch of proof of ergodicity of the Gauss map, and ideas like Knopf's lemma, beginning of mixing ideas. So before stating a Chinese conjecture, I will just recall some elements that are just a nice application of this. And I just would like to say that I might shift from mu to lambda for the Lebesgue measure, but so these are the same. So in this lecture, I will only have one measure, which is Lebesgue measure. So if I shift from mu to lambda, then do not worry, that's the same measure. So here we have a nice expression which says that if you want to know how on a set E, a Borel set E, a map behaves, well, you have to know what happened on its preimage. So this is with the formula of the this operator, it's just a change of variables property. So we have this for any function. So in particular, we have that sum of f applied on inverse branch uh, So it's just I write what happens here for one particular inverse branch. I just have rewritten what happens here explicitly. And if we want to be careful, I really don't want to stick to full cylinders because I have in mind that Jacobi-Perron algorithm is not full, for instance. So just to be careful, we have to I've lost my, yes. So anyway, here it's independent of what I did. So if you want to understand how, what is the measure, how the density behaves on this pre-image, then you get it by this operation. And I have in mind that often, we are fullness, but we're not obliged to have it. So in particular, we have that the measure of a cylinder, if you do it according to n steps, is equal to this integral. Measure. So I will take this color. But just intuitively thinks it's a full space. So that's just a technical detail. But so the measure of a cylinder at nth step is just given by the Jacobian for the continued fraction case. We will recover what we have already seen. No, it's not very... very good idea, but so I will start to try to so I will keep the formula here, in fact. So, just an example for the usual continued fraction. We have seen that the Jacobian is equal to 1 over Qn plus Qn minus x. And so the measure of a cylinder is just the integral of this. And it's equal, it's easily seen to be equal to a value that we have already seen. Square. Thank you. I really don't want to have my square. So now I've got everything what I need to state a Czerny's condition. Which is a sufficient condition, which is not that difficult to fulfill, which will provide existence of an invariant measure. So as I said in the first lecture, by existence of an invariant measure, I mean a measure which is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure and even equivalent. So we will have an invariant measure which is ergodic. And by the way, ergodicity here with respect to Lebesgue measure of with respect to this invariant measure, means the same thing, because we have the same zero sets. So by ergodicity, I mean here that I allow myself to speak of an ergodic transformation, which might be ergodic transformation and measure, even if we don't have invariance with respect to the transformation. So Czerny's condition, and I call it Czerny, but I don't know why, because in fact it's Reyne's condition, so I realize that I make these lapses for a long time. So it's Reyne's condition. which says that if we have topological convergence, plus for all cylinder which is admissible, which can one occur, for which the intersection for which the cylinder is not empty, then the supremum of the value of the Jacobian is connected to the infimum of this value. Yes, thank you. And once again, if the algorithm is not full, I will work on Tn of C of K1, Kn, supremum of this over this Tn of C of K1, Kn. So if I have this condition which says that the maximum value taken by my Jacobian is not too far, does not the discrepancy which is too large and which is not uniform with respect to the infimum, then we will have what we expect. So assume then there exists a measure that is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue, and that is t-invariant, and that is ergodic. And you know that it's a unique probability measure. Well, there's a measure. Doesn't need to be finite, so let's be cautious. So, sorry. So there exists a finite measure, so it exists a unique finite. It's finite, so a unique probability measure. What is interesting here, it's existence. So just to be sure that it's a condition which is not that strong, and for the case of continued fractions, if you look at this expression, well, we have that the supremum of 1 over qn plus qn minus 1x with respect to its infimum, its minimal value, in fact, it's related with respect to a factor 4. So I just have to put my 4. 4 times here. It's just look at the larger value, smallest value. The largest value is given by x is equal to 0. It's 1 over qn, the largest 1 over qn plus qn minus 1. And you will have the fact that qn plus qn minus 1 is smaller than 2qn. So it's not such such a strong condition. It's an important condition, but it's reasonable. And if you look back at the sketch of the proof of ergodicity, it's really what was used here when we compared measures. So I will try to give an idea of the proof, not on the existence of the measure, which is somehow natural in the sense you take once again an accumulation point of measures which have been made prepared to be t-invariant, but I will focus on the ergodicity. So it's an idea which is simple, and you're completely prepared now to it, since you've seen it several times in various lectures. So I want to sketch the proof of the ergodicity. So I want to prove, in fact, that if a set is invariant, then its measure is either the full measure of zero measure. So if my initial state is not the unit cube, you have made suitable renormalizations when I say the one, I mean that I've renormalized the Lebesgue measure so that the measure of my full space is one, even if it's half a square. So I will suppose that mu of E is strictly positive and that E equals T minus 1. So now I will do exactly what we have done before. I will compare this with respect to a cylinder. And my hope will be to give a lower bound of this. My hope is to be able to compare them like this, to compare them maybe up to some constant, and surely up to some constant, but we don't really care about this. So if this is true for any cylinder, then we will use this hypothesis of topological convergence, which implies, in fact, that the sigma algebra generated by the cylinders of order n is sigma algebra, so that is to say you can generate any Borel set with cylinders. It's natural, cylinders shrink to one point, so we are able to generate any Borel set in terms of cylinder. This is also what we have used for continued fractions. So here, if I have such a statement for cylinders, now I can deduce something for any Borel set. I've got this constant, and then I take for f the complement of E to get my contradiction. So what I just have to prove now is that Reni's condition will imply this relation. Well, it's just now a question of computation. We are very close to what we want now. Just compute this measure. Well, since E is T invariant, we've got this relation. And then, well, we just have to use things that are not written on the blackboard anymore. That is to say that this is nothing else than something computed in terms of the Jacobian. On E. I will maybe already think to this possibility. Cylinders are not full, but it's really a detail, once again. So now, what I claim is that I will use my Reni's condition relating the infimum of this with respect to the maximum. And so what I claim is that is now greater than the measure of E. What I do here is I use lower bound via the infimum on E. But the infimum is larger than the supremum divided by something. So now I use the supremum to integrate the Jacobian on my full space, which gives me my measure of the Jacobian, of the cylinder. And I had my constant 1 over C. So Reyni's condition is used here. You have, so if you want, if you prefer, you can divide this by the Jacobian on the full space, the integral of the Jacobian of the full space multiplied by this same value, and you express your infimum and supremum, and you get this minoration. So we have this convenient condition, Reyni's condition, which allows you to obtain something which you can work with. So for usual algorithm, it's not difficult. So to have an invariant measure, so the difficult part will have an explicit expression. So for Brun, you've seen an explicit expression. What remains as a nice open problem is, for instance, for Jacobi Perron, we are not able to produce an explicit expression of the density of the invariant measure. And even to, so what is known is something which has been made by Broise and Guivarche, which is that the density is proved to be analytic, but that's all what we can say for Jacobi Perron. So now that's all what I wanted to say about invariant measure. I will now go to convergence properties. And ergodicity. And I will handle the example of Selmer's algorithm, I make a lot of also lapses. So if I say Selmer, think always fully subtractive. I will only consider fully subtractive here. But have you seen the first lecture? I am tending to say one word for the other one. So I work with a fully subtractive algorithm. And we have seen this, recall how it works. It works on this set, dimension 3. I take 3 entries. And the first one will be the largest. And then I will subtract the smallest to all the other ones. So that is to say, ABC is mapped to the reorganization, the ordering of A minus C, B minus C, and C. So that's the fully subtractive algorithm. So what I'm doing here for the fully subtractive algorithm applies also to the Poincaré algorithm, which consists in subtracting the previous to the next. So these are two very similar algorithms which present the same defects. So by defect, I mean the following remark. I recall the example of the first lecture. If I apply the algorithm on this with phi phi being the golden ratio. I subtract the smallest to the others and I anti-reorder, so that gives me a new value, this one, and then 100 minus 1 over phi square, and I continue. And what you will see, that you will play with these two entries, you will do Euclid algorithm, you always work on these two entries, and you will never be able to touch, to make turn this entry. It will remain here. It will be a little bit affected. Okay, it will be somehow touched by the process, but what you're doing, it's Euclid algorithm here and something on the third coordinate, which does not give you very good approximation of this. So what I want is to clarify what all this means, what this brings in terms of convergence. And to stress the idea that the convergence, which might seem at first view easy to get, given any algorithm, is not that obvious. It's not a direct consequence of any kind of algorithm which looks reasonable. So we'll consider three cases. Case zero will be when you are able to touch the third entry, and case one and case two correspond to the fact to what we do when we display only with the two coordinates. We have only these three cases when we reorder our entries. And if we make our renormalization as we have seen in the last lecture on our entries to make them belong to 0, 1, square. Well, we get something on the algorithm which gives you here xy is mapped in the case 0 to 1 minus y, y, x minus y divided by y. And you could do the same for each map. You have an explicit expression. So I will maybe not give all the computations. But now, what is important is that I can express all these cylinders. So that's a cylinder 0, cylinder 1, cylinder 2 with respect to our notations on which we make different operations. And for instance, cylinder 1 corresponds, cylinder 0 corresponds to the fact that y is larger than 1 minus y, x minus y, so in particular, that reduces to 1 to y larger than 1 half. So how do I see that? I divide by c, by a, which is the largest. So y is larger than 1 minus y, larger than x minus y. So these are just easy computations. So now what it gives? I can draw my cylinders. So that's 1 half. So that will be the cylinder 0, the cylinder 1, cylinder 2. Just given by these conditions, and that I re-expressed in terms of x, y. But then, what will happen with this algorithm? We want to understand what happens here. Is it an isolated case? Does it belong to sets of zero measure that we have discarded? Or is it really something meaningful concerning this algorithm? So, what has happened here? It's that the values here were too small with respect to this one to be able to go to case zero. We have stayed in case one and two. That is to say, we haven't been able to reduce sufficiently the largest entry with respect to C. And now I realize that maybe I confused you because I wrote my entries here like C, B, A. So I'm sorry for this confusion. So A is my largest entry. So the case zero is when you are starting to decrease a largest entry sufficiently to be able to touch it. And in fact, what happens is that as soon as the largest entry is larger than the sum of the to the ones, and I will call this region A like absorbing. So as soon as I'm here, I stay here. Why? Suppose, so for some stage, An is larger than BA plus CN. So that's my nth step. Then An plus 1 will be equal to An minus CN is larger than BN minus CN plus CN, just because we had this relation. So once we are in this absorbing set, we stay in this set. And this set is just here. So something strange appears in this area. It's an absorbing set. And furthermore, if we look at cylinders C of K1, Kn, where the digits belongs to 1, 2, that is to say when we never do this case, when we're in this situation, when we have reached this absorbing set. So if you look at the cylinders, what you see is that they do not shrink to one point, in fact. The cylinders, in fact, contain points, two points that are on the line x plus y equals 1, because when we have equality here, I have equality, and then we have an invariant. So suppose we have equality like that, this is preserved. So that is to say, if A equals B plus C in my algorithm, well, in the next step, I modify my numbers, but I still have A equals B plus C. But A equals B plus C means X plus Y equals 1. So these are fixed points, and the zero, you can check that zero is in such a cylinder. These cylinders are convex sets. So in fact, what happens to them is that, okay, they shrink, but not to a point. They shrink to a needle. So we don't have topological convergence for this algorithm. And what is worst? So we have a set of full measure of needles. So okay, these needles have zero measure, but the set of cylinders which for which it fails is uncountable. And furthermore, this is a theorem due to Mester Nowicki with a beautiful proof by Kreikamp and Mester, which uses Reyne's condition. The condition we just saw, which is not surprising because it's to prove that something has well, zero measure, but well, it's not that surprising. So the theorem they have is that for almost every ABC, then there exists a time such that you will enter the, which will say Tn of x belongs to A, will reach the bad set. That is to say, the limit of this is equal to that is to say, if you apply the algorithm, the two first entries will decrease as here, but the first one will remain positive. Here it's a constant, it's not a good choice, it's a constant gamma, which depends on ABC. So what I want to stress here is that not only we have this bad set, but it's absorbing, you're sure to reach in this set. And that means that for almost every starting point, you won't have convergence. And we can ask also the question of ergodicity, so not it's of the ergodicity of the Lebesgue measure. So we have two, this question can be formulated in two ways. There are two ambient spaces. We have this space, but we have its projection on 0, 1 square, so that I will call x2. And by ergodicity, I mean if E equals T minus 1 E, if we are with this map here, or with this map here, does it imply that mu of E is equal to 0, is equal to 0 if mu of E is strictly positive?
One.
Yeah, it's just, I have the, my problem is, so via the fact that I consider that the measure of this half square is equal to 1. So just full measure or zero measure. Well, in fact, we have two spaces, and what it we can see, it's here, it's non-ergodic. But here, it will be ergodic. The fact that here it's non-ergodic, it's in fact easy to check. So here we have this cone, and in fact, consider the layers. Consider the set of ABC such that nu equals C minus A minus B plus C is strictly positive. So once you are in such a layer, this value is kept, and you won't move from this layer. So that means to say that you have orbits which will come into these layers and won't get out of these layers. Or in other words, this map is T-invariant. It will, so you can't have ergodicity because you have an invariant map, which is not almost everywhere constant. So it's not ergodic here. But here, what is interesting is that you are ergodic, so that being proved by, for instance, by Enk Breun. And so when you work on this space, in fact, this comes from the fact that when you project, even if A is equal to B plus C, it doesn't mean that X plus Y is fixed. So that means to say that you circulate here. Here you're stuck in one layer, but when you make the projectivization given by you're able to move from, to change the layers, and here you are ergodic. So I think it's a characteristic case of what can happen, and on the fact that you have to consider the two levels. I mean, by two levels, I mean the linear level, the cone level, and the projective one. And you have different behaviors. And this is something which happens also for Poincaré, and you have generalizations of fully subtractive and Selmer, and you have Selmer this time, where also you can have this kind of behavior, and you can have in with higher dimensions non-ergodicity, and here and also non-ergodicity here. So this is what I wanted to say about convergence issues. And now to finish, I will say a few general things for the global picture, for what is what we are looking for, what is known, what works well. So I've shown you an example where convergence fails, but I've shown you in the previous lecture a situation where convergence works with Brun algorithm, where we even have strong convergence, not for everybody, but for almost everybody. But for instance, so for Brun we have seen convergence, but for Jacobi-Perron, I haven't said how convergence can be obtained. Well, the idea you will find decline in different guises is collected to Perron Frobenius theory. So as I said, I want my intersection of cones to be equal to some to shrink to some direction. So what is done usually is to use Hilbert projective metric, which is the log of the bi-rapport, and I don't know the English term for bi-rapport. Well, the idea is that you have four points aligned and you make the quotients. Well, anyway, I have no time to enter into the details for Hilbert projective metric. But what how it means, it's a metric which works on a convex compact set, let's say here a cone. And we take we want to compare the distance between two points. It's a metric which corresponds to the idea I want to measure the angle between two points. And then it's defined with respect to the bi-rapport of the given by this 4 points. So the idea is that we want to work in such a situation. But so what happens usually, you are given an algorithm that you have reduced to 0,1 square, so 0,1 to the d. And you want to be able to define such a metric. But if, so here you have to think that in my in this cone, my square is deformed. It's something there. I have cut my cone with a plane, and this is how I get the square. I use either this projectivization, or I go to the simplex where the sum of coordinates is equal to 1. So what I need is to have some more space, because I can have problems on the boundaries. So one technique which is very well explained in the Broise paper in the bulletin of the SMF is to say, okay, let's try to work on a larger set. So we have our map T, which works here. Let's try to find a larger set D1. And let's try to extend T, it's homographies, you can always do that, so that T of D is shrinked into D1, which is in the interior of D. And you have transformed your map T into a contraction with respect to this metric. That is to say, we have we were here, we try to shrink a little bit the algorithm to stay within a cone, and the D, you will have to think of D as a cone that you put on D, and your algorithm shrinks these cones and makes a contraction. So you have to find a contraction. And once you have a contraction, when you get your convergence of the algorithm, and you can also apply Perron-Frobenius theorems to get, if you don't want to make Rennie's condition, you can apply Perron-Frobenius and Krasnolskalski sorry, theorem to get existence of invariant measure. So that's the idea which is behind, a contraction that's behind Perron-Frobenius theory, finding a contraction. So that's an idea that you can also find in the context of interval exchange in the paper by Forni and Avila on the weak mixing of interval exchanges. Create a contraction. So for Jacob Huperon, that's how things work well, and for it's an idea you find for many algorithms. And just to finish, what if we come back to the original motivation, which were quality of approximation, then we have what is expected from this algorithm is to not only to have so good contraction properties like that, but also to have something which corresponds to properties associated to strong convergence. So we want this algorithm to not only to shrink vectors created like that, if I put my three vectors as I did previously. Not only do I want to shrink vectors, but also I want to control the way, the contraction ratio. So one nice way to measure it is to associate with continued fraction algorithms so-called Lyapunov exponent, which correspond to the limit of the logarithm of the k-fold wedge product of the matrix, the non-negative matrix I have. So I want to understand the growth ratio of the colons I have, or on the distance between vectors. And then we have something which we can consider call a Pisot condition, which is the following. If the second Lyapunov exponent is negative, then that's what we call a Pisot condition. That is to say, we will be exactly as in the same framework as in the Pisot case. Just to give maybe an intuitive idea, lambda R1 corresponds to the growth of the length of the colons. So it corresponds to half, to something connected to the entropy and to the usual P square over six logs 2 in the continued fraction case. And lambda 2 corresponds to this quantity, the distance to the nearest integer for continued fractions. So lambda 2 measures the distance to the line. So we say it's Pisot when you have something which stretches matrices but which converge very fast. Here, like does a Pisot matrix. If you iterate a Pisot matrix, it has an expanding line and a contracting plane. We want to have the same situation. So this Lyapunov exponent exists, are proved to exist, and for all the reasonable algorithms we have. And moreover, what we have usually, we have this condition on the second exponent, which is negative. And what is important as information is to compare this to the Dirichlet value, which corresponds to the approximation of so you have, if I've got two entries, d is equal to 2. So I want to compare the quality of approximation with respect to 3/2, if I am if I've got two parameters. And then what is important is to understand this quantity and to see, because if you just want to compare the growth rate of this quantity given by lambda 2 and the growth rate given by Qn, so simple computations shows you that this is this quantity you want to understand. And now for most of the algorithms we have, Brun, Jacobi, Perron, we are under 3/2. So for Brun, if my memory is good, we have, Sébastien made the computation recently, 1, 3, 6, so something like that, Fourbrun, to check. There's a nice paper by Baladi Noguera, who gives also nice nice results on this. So they are able to design an algorithm which gives one point four. But anyway, we are not able to reach 3.5 as we have been able to do with LLL algorithm, for instance, in the last lecture. And the question is whether it's possible to reach 3.5 with this kind of algorithms, and we have the feeling that it won't be the case. So sorry for being long, and thank you very much.